that you committing that whole day before God.
That's
right. Amen. Okay, so you're starting your day and committing it before God. And what that means is that within the day, this is what happens. You have what is called God consciousness.
Yeah. Mm.
You have God consciousness because you started that day with God, because God, his presence is with you. Now, don't get me wrong, okay? This is the difference. His presence is with you every single day,
yeah.
Every single time, okay? Because Jesus said, "Lo, I am with you, even unto the ends of the earth." But here's the problem. You might not be conscious of that presence.
Start tuning in.
You see? And when you're not conscious of the presence of God, what happens is that you are most likely to drift out of his presence into the flesh.
Yeah.
Mm. Amen. So that's why we start the day with prayer. That's why we commit that day before God. And you find out that because of that, you're more conscious of who you are. You're more conscious of his presence. You're more conscious of his power. When temptations come your way, okay, when trouble come your way, guess what? Because you're conscious of his power, because you're conscious of his presence, what happens is that you are much more equipped to put up a resistance against that trouble, against that temptation. Hallelujah. So that's actually what it means to build a solid foundation. Hallelujah. That's what it means to build a solid foundation. And when that solid foundation is there, so what then happens is that we can overcome. Because that's what Jesus said. Last week, I told you, when we talk about the rain and the wind and all that, it's not hard for us to understand, okay? The rain and the wind and the flood and everything that came against that house, they are all the things of this world. The pressures of this world. How many of you have seen life squeeze some people so much, you know, that they go into depression? We've seen life squeeze people so much, you know, it's not a good thing, but people take their life.
That's right.
Because they cannot handle the pressures of this life anymore. What is that? That is a house that is not built on the solid ground.
Mm.
Again, like I said before, I'm really sorry. I don't know how to sugarcoat it. I don't know how else to say it, hallelujah, other than to repeat what Jesus has said, that if any man that hears my voice and he obeys, is like that man that is building his house on a solid rock. Amen. I'm just going to deviate a little, and I'm going to go into prayers and just show you just a little bit of how to actually build that solid rock. You know, because it's important, very, very important. For me, I believe one of the greatest privileges that God has given us is salvation. Amen. But salvation is not just deliverance from sin. Okay? It's not just that your name is blotted out of the book of, you know, death and condemnation written in the book of life. It's much more than that. What salvation means is that you now have the opportunity and the privilege to enjoy God's life.
Mm.
You now have God living within you, and you have that opportunity every day to actually come into the presence of God and get life. Mm. It's like the manna. You all remember manna? Okay, when the Israelites were in the wilderness, what happens was that God fed them every day. 40 years. Hallelujah. 40 good years, God fed them. And the way God fed them was with manna.
Mm.
So every morning, you see, every morning they have to take their things, they have to go out of the camp and go and collect that manna. And when they come, then they eat with their family. Okay? If you try and keep it overnight, what happens is that the manna's words. Why? Why? Because God does not want you living on leftovers.
Yeah. Mm.
Because God wants you to come into his presence daily.
Mm.
He wants you to receive that fresh breath from him daily. Because guess what? Yesterday's revelation is good, but it's not good enough for today. Hallelujah. You need to come daily into his presence to get that fresh breath. That's why Jesus said, okay, when he, you see, the disciples of Jesus came to him and said, Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us how to pray. Just as John taught his disciples how to pray. First of all, what does that tell you? This is the real deal. This is important.
Yeah.
If it were not important, the disciples would not have been asking for it.
It's true.
That means it's important. Hallelujah. And Jesus did not hesitate. Hallelujah. Therefore, he taught them how to pray. But one of the things Jesus taught them, he said, when you pray, he said, give us this day, our daily bread. Hallelujah. Because God wants us to depend on him every day. And you know what? That's the best life we can have. When we depend on God on a daily basis. Amen. Therefore, you see, one of the ways in which you can actually build a solid foundation, is when you are equipped and when you make it a habit to be able to seek the face of God every single day. Every single day. And you can do it. You can do it. You just need to be taught how. Amen. You know, there's a certain man I used to listen to. He said, everything is easy if you know how. Everything is easy if you know how. That's it. You know, if I talk to you about brain surgery, you know, I'm sure nobody here is a brain surgeon. But if you are a brain surgeon and you've been practicing for the last, you know, 30 years, it is hard for everybody else. But because you have that wealth of knowledge and experience behind you, you know, it's easier than somebody who has no clue. You see, everything is easy if you know how. Amen. And again, tonight, I just want to talk briefly about this solid foundation that we need to lay. Hallelujah. And when you lay an anchor your Christian life, okay, on getting and drawing life from God on a daily basis, I tell you, your life will be different. Then you will see growth in your Christian life. Hallelujah. Then you will see the Word of God actually come alive. You will see the Bible, when you read it, it takes a different meaning. Hallelujah. Bible says the Word became flesh. It will not be just black and white anymore. You know why? Because God is breathing on it. Hallelujah. And His breath is life. Amen. So I'm briefly just going to talk about this. Why? Because it is important. And I actually see it as one of the things that many believers are actually not versed in. Many believers are not conversant with. Hallelujah. Now, it does require discipline. I told you before. Yeah? The only way to grow is to exchange. Actually, in this life, if you stop exchanging, you will just die. You will die. If you are so stingy, yeah, that you say, I'm not going to let that carbon dioxide from my nostrils. I'm going to keep all of them in. You will die. Because that's how we live. We exchange. You let carbon dioxide out, you let oxygen in. It's exchange. Your lungs is doing all the works. Yeah? Carbon dioxide out, oxygen in. Exchange. It's the same way. If you want to grow, you must be able to exchange your time, your energy, your money, yes, your money, your time, hallelujah, for the things of God. Sometimes you have to spend hours and hours studying your Bible. Sometimes you have to spend hours in prayers. But what I'm about to show you tonight, like I believe, is one of the solid ways of laying a foundation for our Christian life. The good news is that once you get this formula, and you start to use it and use it and use it every time, the next day becomes easier. The next day becomes easier. The next day becomes easier. Amen. And very soon you'll be able to enter to and fro into the presence of God without any hindrance.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, you first of all must understand that when God created Adam and Eve, they had the best life ever. Not just because of the garden. Okay? But because the Bible said in the cool of the day, God will come down and God will fellowship with Adam and Eve. God will talk to them and they will talk back to God. Hallelujah. But this is what happened. When sin came in the equation, that relationship was broken. You know why? Because God is of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. Amen. The relationship was broken. And then God drove them out of the Garden of Eden. Everybody say Eden.
Eden.
Okay? But when God drove them out, they went westward. Okay? In the garden, he drove them towards the west. Okay? And then he put cherubim to guard the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Okay? Therefore, when the Israelites, when they built the temple, they built it in such a way that you actually go in and travel in west-east orientation. What does that mean? Because they had it in their mind, okay? They're going back, very sharp. They're going back into the presence of God. Is that making sense?
Yeah.
Because that's where God drove Adam and Eve away from. Okay, they went towards the west. Okay? So when they designed the temple, and when God gave Moses the blueprint of the tabernacle, it was designed in such a way that you're actually going from west to the east, back into the presence of God. You've got to understand, as a human being, this is the greatest gift God has given unto us. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Gift of salvation, and that encompasses and includes the ability to have what Adam and Eve lost. And that is to come into the presence of God. Hallelujah. Like I told you before, this is how you build a solid foundation. Those of you that are just joining us, Jesus said in Luke chapter 6 from verse 46 onwards, everybody that hears my word and do them is like a man who built his house on a solid rock. The wind came, the flood came, and it beat upon the house, but the house kept standing. But everyone who hears my word and does not do it is like that man that built his house on the sand. When the wind came and the flood came, the house could not withstand the force, and great was the fall of that house. You know why? Because some man took the time to understand the things of God, took this time to study the things of God and put it into practice. Whereas the other man, all he was interested in was the facade, the glory. Hey, look at me, look at me. I got a house too. It's not just you, I got a house too. Yeah? That's what he was more interested in. Instead of having a long-lasting foundation, a long-lasting relationship with God. Hallelujah. Now, how many of you have seen some Christians? They come in with so much zeal when they first get born again. There's so much zeal, so much energy. They want to do everything. They're the first to come to church. They clean the church. They clean even the things that should be clean and the things should not be clean. They clean everything. Yeah, they're full of zeal, evangelism, a prayer meeting, choir practice, everything. If there's no church, they'll be angry. Hey, pastor, why is there no church service on Thursday? If there's not, then they create one because they're full of zeal, okay? But after a while, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, what happens, yeah, when the pressures of this life begin to come, you know, the rain and the wind, what happens, that zeal begins to go down and down and down and down. And at the end of the day, it's not sustainable. They cannot sustain that zeal. You know why? Because they haven't taken time to learn. Hallelujah. They're just busy doing all these things instead of busy building a foundation.
Hmm.
You understand what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Instead of building that solid foundation on the rock, they're just busy with church activities so that everybody will see me. Hallelujah. Well, that might not be their original intention, but I tell you, a wise man, according to what Jesus said, is the one that is not so concerned about the facade, not so concerned about the outward, was taking the time and the effort and the energy to build that solid rock. Hallelujah. So basically,